Well, hello everyone. Happy to join you by video conference. My name is Tim Bird. I'm the Architecture Group Chair of the CE Work Group and the Linux Foundation. I'm also a software engineer at Sony Mobile Corporation. And this is a traditional speech that I give just about every Jamboree, not every single one, but very many of them. And I also give this at Embedded Linux Conference every once in a while. Status of Embedded Linux. So next slide. So this is an overview of the areas that I want to cover. I want to talk about the last few kernel versions, then go into the specific technology areas where some things are changing. I'll talk about the CE Workgroup projects, the things that the members of the CE Workgroup are doing, and then add a few miscellaneous items, and then give a link to some resources. So let's start right off with kernel versions. So if you look at the current versions, we just entered the merge window, December 7th was when version 3.18 came out, and it had about the right time period on it, 63 days. That's just a little over 2 months. So we seem to have entered a period where we're doing kernel releases pretty close to maybe 8 or 9 weeks long. That's a pretty good thing. We're in the merge window now. So there has not been a release candidate yet for the kernel. We'll probably see that. I think Dana said something about doing one by about the 21st, so maybe next week sometime. But we already have a pretty good idea from the changes that have been merged what's going to come in 3.19, and I will go ahead and talk about that a little bit later. So. If we look at the last couple kernels, some of the major features, I've talked about these before, so for 3.16 and 3.17, I'll go over these a little bit faster. But in 3.16, we had power-aware scheduling, so there's been a lot of effort going into power management things for the kernel. There was a new feature, a decode stack trace, converts offsets in a stack trace to file names and line numbers. That's a new tool that's in the kernel source tree. That's very handy for looking at oops messages and stack traces and things, particularly when you do not have KLSIMs loaded. Then F2FS, which is a popular flash file system developed by Samsung, it added large volume support, so that flash file system continues to be developed and worked on. So next slide. In 3.17, there was a lot of different things that went in, but probably the biggest kind of area, there was a whole lot of ARM SoC support in. So there's a lot of work going on now to support a bunch of different ARM processors. There's still a lot of code out of tree, and I'll talk about that later. There's still a lot of work to be done, but it is good to see that there's a lot of new boards in. In particular, and when we get to 3.19, we'll see some kind of new chipsets going. But we see Allwinner coming in there, and Tegra, and some Gumstick Pepper AM V35. So those AM, I think those are OMAP boards or chipsets. The K-Test had a little bit of a rework of its config bisect support. So in 3.17, here's some more hardware support that came in. Oh no, that's right. Okay, so let's move on. 3.18.
Yeah.
Okay, so 3.18 just was officially released on December 7th. So it's a fairly new kernel, although we knew these features back in October when the merge window opened. The features don't really change that much between when the merge window opens and when it finally gets published as a final release. But here, some of the features that were interesting were overlay FS, and I'm going to talk about that later. Support for MAdvise and FAdvise now can be configured out. This is part of a a large set of what we used to call Linux tiny patches, now referred to often as tinification of the kernel. So we're continuing to see patches go in to reduce the system size. Actually, in 3.18, we saw some more patches having to do with LLVM support. LLVM is getting really, really close to being able to compile the kernel with no patches at all needed. Then again, more SoC support. So we see a HiSilicon chip in there. That's a chip that's used by Huawei in some of their phones. We're seeing ArenaSauce, AM Logic, Broadcom, and an Atmel chip. So lots of an SoC support is going in, which is good overall for the industry. So next slide. So 3.19, of course, we're just in the merge window. OFAC has not closed, so it's possible even more stuff will come in. It takes a while for things to merge all these different things, but we are kind of towards the tail end of the merge window. We're in it about a week now, and we have another week to go, but I think most of the major features have been put in. Some of those are that F2FS now has a fast boot option, and when I talk about boot time and technologies, I'll talk a little bit more about that. There's device tree overlay support. And this is really interesting. This is useful for boards that have daughter boards, such as Capes or Shield. So things like the BeagleBone or the middle board that have future boards that you can pair with them that need device tree changes. And there's a whole article on LWN.net about this. There was a really great talk that was given at ELC about this, and you can read the article about that talk and go find the slides on the Linux Foundation website by the guy that was working on this. So it's a very useful feature for a certain segment of the market. Also, SquashFS had kind of a minor upgrade, but it now supports LT4 compression. So another version of compression. Kind of the big news, and I talked about this last time, in terms of Android support, is that Greg Kroah Hartman moved the binder code from the staging tree into the regular tree. So binder is an official API of the kernel now. And there were people who objected, but everybody kind of realized, look, there's over a billion phones that have to have this API in order for their user space stacks to work. So it's kind of silly not to kind of pretend it's not an official API. Anyway, there are people who still don't like it, but it's it. Okay, so there's some things to watch going forward. The Android patches in general and staging, there's some effort to actually reduce that, either to remove them completely from the kernel. There are a couple Android features in that category, or just take them out of staging and put them into the regular kernel. So that's something to kind of pay attention to. It'll be really nice. Someday, I think, we'll be able to take a mainline kernel with zero patches and run Android on top of it. I got pretty close to it a couple of years ago, but since then, some other stuff changed in Android. Another watch, I think, is KDBus. And the reason for that is there's been a big push to get DBus integrated into the kernel. And actually, this move to put binder out of staging is related to that. So there are some people in the Linux community who would like to see Android use a common framework like KDBus instead of binder. There's some people who don't like binder, some of the features it has. But anyway, I'm getting DBus integrated into the kernel as KDBus. And then kernel tinification, there's a whole list of patches. People continue to work on this in order to get the system smaller. And there's actually a couple of different things going on I'll refer to later. And then systemd and embedded. Systemd continues kind of its long march into all of the desktop distributions, and in particular Debian has switched over to systemd, and so that's going to filter. There are embedded systems now that are based on Debian, that will kind of inherit that as they move forward to more current versions of Debian. But also things like Angstrom, another embedded distribution which is quite popular, had already integrated systemd over a year ago. So we're probably going to see that. We'll probably just have to figure out how to work with that. Systemd does have some good features in terms of boot up time. It's a little bit monolithic, so there are some issues there. But there was actually a good talk about systemd in the embedded space at ELC Europe. And I highly recommend looking at that talk and seeing, I think it was even given by Leonard Pottering, so by the expert himself. Good talk to check out. So next slide. This is just, I wanted to highlight kind of where we stand in terms of contributions. Sony does not end up looking too good on this chart. This is contributions by different companies over a period of releases. I've been doing some analysis because of the device mainlining project that I'm doing in the CE workgroup. And so I've been looking at the number of commits that different companies have been making and how many developers they have who are interacting with the community. So Sony Mobile or Sony Ericsson has very few, only 43 commits and by 14 different developers. So that's less than four commits per developer. If you see some of the other SoC companies or phone companies are doing quite a bit better. So LG and Huawei are two mobile phone companies, and they have kind of, you know, between 500 and 1,000 in that range number of commits that they've done in the kernel. You look at Motorola, who's also a cell phone company. They're much higher, and they have very few developers. Their commits are concentrated in just a very small group, doing lots of work over a long period of time. But you look at some of the chip vendors, like Qualcomm, Samsung, and Intel. So Samsung has been increasing their contribution to the kernel, and they're now at, you know, their 8,600 commits. That's pretty healthy. I haven't checked to see how many of those are. It's kind of difficult to see how many are split between like their Qualcomm work and their own SoC work. There's quite a few of these that are probably coming out of their SoC division and may even be really, really old. But when I did the commit count, I didn't limit it to just from 3-4 up. But you can see that they're a pretty major contributor. And then Intel is kind of the gold standard for commits to the kernel of 32,000 and 438 contributors. So they have an awful lot of people contributing, and that's obviously one of the reasons Intel is so well supported. So some of these companies at the top of the list have a ways to go in terms of increasing their contributions and actually making life easier for themselves. I just thought it was kind of an interesting thing to show. This is on a kernel that I just downloaded actually today, so it gives you an idea where companies stand, and there's a lot more work to be done. So having said that, even with all these commits that companies are making, like, you know, Qualcomm's making 2,000 commits in the last couple of years, they still have a good, most kernels have about 1.5 million lines of code that are out of mainline. And I'll talk a little bit more about some of the results I've been doing in my device mainline project. I'll come back to that in a minute. Anyway, so that's just kind of some contribution notes about different companies.
It must be quite important to add one more company within this list, because I see that Renesas is increasing quite rapidly.
I should have been a Renesas line in there.
That's accompanied with the LTS cycle. Many people seem to be so much encouraged to make some of the upstreaming within our Renesas-related people. So that I hope you to include the scope of this investigation, Renesas to include this investigation, which might be quite showing another, you know, important aspect. maybe LTSI's another you know, benefit will be there to make an encouragement for the upstream.
Yeah, I probably should have included Renaissance. That would, they would have some interesting numbers, I'm sure. This is kind of focused pretty heavily on the mobile phone kind of players.
Yeah.
Sony Mobile cooperates with and competes with. It's kind of a category. Okay, anyway, so moving on. So let's go through some technology areas and talk about some things that are going on. So in terms of boot up time, not a whole lot of things. The last time I gave the presentation, I referred to several talks at ELC Europe. So you can go look at those. The only thing I could find in the kernel was this F2FS file system that has a new fast boot option. And what it allows you to do is get some boot time checks that the file system normally makes. Now, I'm not sure if it's advisable to do that every time. Didn't really dig into the details, but the option is there if you happen to be using that file system. So next slide. I've got nothing on graphics. I don't see a whole lot changing in the industry on graphics. It's kind of not in the kernel. Anyway, moving along. So file systems, a couple of interesting things. So SquashFS supports a new compression algorithm. It already supported like I think three or four others. This is not terribly newsworthy. The big thing in my opinion is this OverlayFS. So this is gives you support to put a read-write file system over the top of a read-only file system. Now you don't have to structure it that way, but that is kind of the intended use. And it's really, really handy. The most common use case is live CDs, so people can actually run Linux off of a CD and have a read-write file system on top of that. Linux can function, you know, primarily off of a read-only medium. Things were done before with something called UnionFS, but OverlayFS is quite a bit more flexible. The nice thing about this is that although it's intended for live CDs, it is actually pretty useful for some important embedded scenarios. Particularly, it allows you to put portions of your root file system on read-only media. So even in ROM or in protected flash, and still get kind of read-write semantics. It greatly simplifies doing certain types of systems where you want to upgrade a portion of the system but make sure that you still cannot corrupt the data that came from the factory. So that's pretty neat. That's a neat addition. Anyway, next one. So power management. At ELC Europe, there was a big focus on power management measurement devices. And we're continuing to see that. A lot of little devices that have been released to help companies measure power. Then at Plumbers, several talks about things that would help overall with power management. Talking about performance versus battery life. Wanting to get some performance hinting for apps that would allow the scheduler to make better decisions, and pinning some things to the little processor. So taking some items, normally in a, when you have an asymmetric processor, things can flow wherever they want, but sometimes you can actually get better power performance by constraining the system so that some items will only run on the what I call the little processor. So, next slide. So, the big thing that is going on in the community right now, it's been going on for over a year already, energy-aware scheduling. Some patches have already gone in. I think I mentioned those. I think they were in 3.17. Some energy-aware scheduling patches went in. And also, choice of idle state is really, really important to get the most battery life. You don't want to, there's always a trade-off between how long it takes to get to a particular idle state and the amount of it will be saved and the cost of actually getting there and coming back out of it. And so there's been a lot of work recently on a better idle time predictor. So there's a good article in alphabetn.net talking about the idle time predictor in the kernel and some of the new techniques they're using to try to help the scheduler make better choices about how long the system's going to be idle. Ultimately, so they can choose better sleep days. And then there are some tools to measure and analyze energy efficiency is ongoing work. No big breakthroughs. There's a few tools under development right now. Should be interesting in about a year. And then CPU Freak, trying to continually integrate this into the scheduler. And so this is the runtime power and how fast to run the CPU. This kind of goes along with how the sleep states. It's really a kind of a difficult problem trying to determine how best to utilize the resources to meet the needs of the user while still saving power. Next slide. Real time. So real time is just kind of bad news. I already covered this a little bit, but I've added a couple more resources here. The real time preamp patch set is no longer commercially funded. There are no commercial supporters of the project. Thomas Weitzner and his company are just handling it on a hobbyist basis. And so we may or may not see additional releases. He has said that he'll try not to just abandon the patch set completely, but he does have, you know, a family to feed and he's got other paying customers. And so we don't know what'll happen with this. RT preamp patch set, which is one of the real-time solutions in the Linux kernel. The other solution, or traditional solution, is called ZMI, and uses something called the COBOL real-time core. That is still, that's also out of tree, but it's still actively maintained. And then Jim Huang, actually at ELC Europe, proposed another one, RTMux, a thin multiplexing layer. And so there are people still actively working on real-time solutions for Linux, including new proposals like Jim Huang's. But the RT preamp patch set is actually in a pretty bad state right now in terms of its ongoing support. Okay, yeah, that's good. So system science. So I already talked about this a little bit. This is all the way back from the Kernel Summit in August. There was a renewed kernel size reduction project. They don't want to call it Linux Tiny, so they started to call it Tinification. I don't know if that's a better name. I kind of like the tiny name myself. But there was a good article about the overall goals of the project on LWN.net, and they now have a kernel wiki, kernel.org wiki. And the project page, a list of the things that they're working on. It's a pretty long page, actually, talking about all the different ways to cut down the size of the Linux kernel. And you can see over time they've actually making some pretty good progress. So there's a syscall elimination. So there was the splice syscall, and I think about three or four other syscalls that were related to the splice operation to do in-kernel data transfer on certain file descriptors. Was just posted to the kernel mailing list, and there's a good discussion of a good article about some of the discussion that was had on that on LWN.net. Already integrated into the kernel was support to get rid of mAdvise and fadvise. None of these patches are really, really huge in the amount of space they save, but if you have enough of them, they kind of start to add up over time. There's always pushback when these patches get submitted to the kernel. This time around, there's discussion about how modular the kernel should be. Well, the kernel's already got 14,000 config options, so one argument is that adding a couple more is not that big of a deal. One developer said, well, it's a slippery slope to make these things conditional. It's like other people came back and said, well, we've been on that slope for many, many years, so that's not a very good argument. Another thing completely separate from these size-related patches is there's actually a new configuration option in the kernel source tree. This was mainlined in 3.17, called Make Tiny Config. And this is actually a really handy thing. So it's good to have a consistent baseline between systems that people can then use to compare their numbers. And so there now is, you can type make tiny config and you'll get a very, very, very minimal config. And you can use that as a baseline for making size measurements. And so the basic goal, you know, if you want to add features to the kernel, that's fine. Those features probably won't be turned on in tiny config. The goal then, as people test, as people try to make improvements in the kernel, is make sure the tiny config either gets smaller or does not grow over time. And that's a shift. We haven't had like kind of a stake in the ground before in the kernel. So this I think will be very useful going forward. Let's see. In terms of tool chains, I already kind of mentioned LLVM. There are more fixes for LLVM support in 3.18, including the LLVM is being used on lots of different projects, including the Linux kernel. Dan Webster always gives an update. He gave another one at PLC Europe. I'd probably do another one at Collab Summit in just another couple months. And they've actually built Android with Plane, which is the C compiler. So if you look at the next slide, you see some of the results there. They actually have built the kernel and the Android open source project for the Nexus 7 and 10 and can boot and run many of the apps, not all of them. Nexus 4 and 5 are still having some problems, but they've got a bunch of patches submitted upstream to the Android open source project and the kernel, and 74 patches have been accepted so far. So the GCC performance is still better than LLVM, but having a second compiler turns out to be really handy, even if you don't use it in production. Different compilers look at the code in different ways, and so Clang is actually useful, even if you use it to find things that GCC does not catch. So that's actually really good. I'll be quite happy when I can choose whether to use LLVM or GCC to build the kernel. Okay, next slide. In terms of testing, I think the most interesting thing recently is the new kernel subsystem test, which is called K-self-test. This was talked about a lot at the kernel summit. It's a brand new initiative. It's very new. It's a little bit rough around the edges. It needs to mature quite a bit, but it has made some good progress. One of the things that I think is related to embedded is there is now a size test, and if you want to see how that runs, if you have the kernel booting on your system, you can do make targets equal size K-self test, and that will actually select the size self test out of the set of tests that you could run. So unfortunately, we still need some work to support cross-build and deploy to target. In order to make this all work really well with embedded systems, we can't just be doing all this building and running on a host. And so there's some more work to be done in the K-self test system, but it's coming along a little bit slowly, but I think it's going in the right direction. So that's really good. Next slide. Okay, so that's it for technology areas. Now I'd like to go into kind of the CE work group projects. So this is a bit of interesting news I think people should know about. We're officially stopping the open project proposal. We did that for over a period of several years. We used to open up the process of proposing projects to be funded to the community. We've asked the community for help identifying projects. One of the things we found is that there were useful projects that were proposed, but the results have been very disjointed. They've been kind of small, fragmented projects. No project was kind of individually big enough to rally around as an industry. And so basically, we're not going to do that anymore. Instead, we're switching to a model where the project requirements will drive the contractor project. So, for example, if the Internet of Things project finds a requirement either in security or protocols or size, and that can be met by finding a contractor, then we'll consider that. So I, you know, we're not actually, if someone has a good idea from the community, we're not going to just ignore it, but we're not going to have this formal process that we used to have to have community members suggest projects. We'll try to derive those more from our work group activities. Okay, so having said that, what are our work group activities? So we have currently four projects that we're working on, kind of high-level projects. Our project areas are the Internet of Things, a standard embedded distribution, Linux and social infrastructure, and device mainlining. And of these projects, I'm probably most qualified to talk about device mainlining because that's the one that I'm kind of heading up. So what have we done so far in device mainlining? Well, first, we did some research on obstacles to mainlining. We conducted a survey of developers, and we presented the results of that survey at ELC Europe. We also, at ELC Europe, had a birds of a feather session and what I refer to as a hallway track. We had lots of discussions in the hallway about best practices for overcoming those obstacles. We are continuing that work, researching the current SoC status. So one of the things that's happened is we've collected many source trees for commercial products, most of them related to phones, because that's kind of where my area of expertise is. But I'd be interested in getting other source code for other products. And we started looking for patterns of materials that are missing from mainline. So one of the things we want to do is see if there's a particular area of the kernel that is very poorly represented. The people are using it in products, but there's no mainline support for it from any SoC vendor. And what that may indicate that the framework or the structure of the kernel is not very good in that area. And a couple of areas kind of jump out, but I'll talk about those later. So next slide. So what we want to do, so that was what we have done, what we're in process of doing. Here's some things that we would like to do. We plan to write a mainlining best practices white paper, and have it published by the Linux Foundation. We encountered lots of problems. Well, I encountered lots of problems while I was researching the published SoC trees. And I'm trying to decide now, I need to work with the group of people who are interested in this, decide whether to publish problem reports on that. Quite a few companies are not well, they just have, there are problems in the source trees that they're publishing. Some of them could be fixed with tooling. Others may need to be fixed with better publication practices. And I don't know how, it is not the goal of this project to kind of help people overcome their GPL violations. This is not really about GPL violations. So to the degree that there's some problem publishing the code, that's not the point. The real point is just to try to find out, well, what's being published, what's out of mainline, what's the difference between what people are publishing and what's in mainline, and how can we make it easier to contribute patches upstream. So one of the things that we also plan to do is to write some tools that will help companies find patches that are good candidates for upstreaming. Some of the ideas that we have there are to write some tools that will identify if a patch is on top of an out-of-tree subsystem or an in-tree subsystem. There are some ways that we think we can do that, and that will help people identify when they're being dependent on non-upstream code and where it's going to be a lot more work to get their code upstream. And then another area is we want to continue analyzing that source that we've got to find areas where Linux upstream frameworks are lacking. So one that I am pretty familiar with, just on my work at Sony, we know that USB on the go support is kind of lacking. Almost nobody has, almost every SoC tree, I think every SoC tree, is missing a whole bunch of code in their USB on-the-go stuff. And part of that is because there actually is no upstream support for the charging interfaces. So USB on-the-go has to support switching between peripheral and host mode. And when it does that, it has to switch in and out of a charging mode, and that integration, there's no framework in upstream to handle that. And so everybody's done it on an ad hoc fashion in their own kernel. So that's something where maybe if the industry came together, they could find a fix that would make it easier to upstream things. That's just an example of the type. So the other CE workgroup projects, the next steps that we want to do is we will be holding some more project meetings at ELC. So we're planning some meetings on the Internet of Things, device mainlining, and infrastructure. And particularly the IoT meeting will be focusing on requirements. The device mainlining meeting will be focusing on this continuing research on the SoC trees and some of the tools that I talked about. And I'm actually not sure what the infrastructure one is going to be about, but I know that they have requested it. Next slide. I think that's it. Okay, so that's it for the CE workgroup. Well, so for those new CE workgroup projects, another project that is ongoing is the long-term support initiative, and then the eLinux wiki, it continues to be supported. So next slide. I think that there's a talk this afternoon at the Jamboree about LTSI, and specifically about the testing initiative. So I don't think I'll cover a bunch of that here, but there are many presentations available on the status, presentations at both ELC and ELC Europe. The latest project push is for a testing facility. I think that's a really good project. We've been talking about having somewhat slower release schedules and a mechanism to support additions after the merge window. To help encourage more participation in that project. But I'll let people who are talking about that, they have a lot more better information about it. And then next, the eLinux Wiki, we continue to support that. It's a great website dedicated to information for embedded Linux developers. We have, it's still a very actively developed site, especially the hardware side of it. There's hundreds of pages covering numerous topic areas, boot-up time, real-time, security, power management, flash, file system, you name it, just the pages on the wiki, and we encourage everybody to go out and not just read the information, but also add to it when they know about things. Okay, next slide. I think now we're just going to get to kind of the miscellaneous stuff. I have a couple of areas that I want to talk about. We'll talk about events, projects, consortia, and a little bit about distros. So in terms of events, the next big event from the Linux Foundation and the CE workgroup is the Embedded Linux Conference coming up in March. And our theme for this year is drones, things, and automobiles. We'll have talks, complete tracks. We hope to have complete tracks on drones, and on the Internet of Things, and on automotive. We've got some great keynote speakers. I can't announce them yet, but we're very excited about the things we've got planned for the event already, and we haven't even gotten through our proposal submission. So proposals, we're still collecting those. Those are due on January 9th. We encourage everyone to come, and in particular, if you have something about drones, IoT, or automotive, please make a proposal to speak. Also, we're co-located again this year, as we have in the past, have been in the past with Android Builder Summit. There's a lot of great content at Embedded Linux Conference. And then Embedded Linux Conference Europe, we're already looking ahead to that. That will be in October. We've got the dates for that, the 5th through the 7th in Dublin, Ireland. So somewhere new to travel to in Europe. Let's see, next slide. Okay, in terms of projects, some of the projects that have had kind of some recent activity are the Alcyon Alliance, which is really addressing the networking portion of Internet of Things. AllJoin is the name of the implementation. This is a project hosted by the Linux Foundation. There's the Purple Foundation, which just started, really announced itself at Embedded Linux Conference Europe. And it's a MIPS nonprofit, multiple company, and they're doing quite a few things to help promote MIPS CPU in embedded. And then another project at the Linux Foundation is Drone Code for open source UAV software. UAV stands for unmanned aerial vehicle, but I think they actually don't restrict themselves to aerial. I think they also cover rovers, so autonomous wheeled vehicles as well. Anyway, there's you can go look at dronecode.org. We will be having our first Linux Drone Summit at ELC. Andrew Tridgell, who is the technical lead, the technical architect for the Drone Code and the head of the Linux, I can't remember the name of it. Anyway, one of the main projects in this area. He's actually on the program committee for ELC, so he's helping us get the vet the content for that portion of the event. Next slide. Okay, finally, in distros, I don't have a whole lot here. I think most people are aware that Android has switched to Lollipop, which is the L release. I don't even know what version number. Maybe it's 5. I don't know. There's lots of changes in the upper portions of the stack. A lot of stuff had to do with kind of the look and feel of it. But not a whole lot of kernel changes. There has been a few kernel-level changes. For example, Lollipop no longer uses the logger in the kernel. So that's kind of interesting. That may actually get dropped. That was one of the discussions having to do with Android features in the kernel. Tizen, just based on reports from their last developers conference, which was, I believe, in November, they're doing a lot of security work with SMAC. They have proposed there's Tizen. You can now build Tizen with the Yocto project, and they have proposed that some of their layers that they built can be used by other projects that are using the Yocto project. There's a really interesting set of talks given at the Tizen Developer Summit on small system work, Internet of Things, and Tizen Micro. Although their definition of micro was not as small as I would have liked. I think what I saw was they were talking about systems with 128 meg of RAM. And I kind of think of a small system as something with 2 meg of RAM. There's a good article on LWDM.net talking about that Tizen micro work. And hopefully Tizen will continue to develop it. It looks like it's doing pretty well as a embedded Linux distro. Next slide. So, that's pretty much all I have for this. My resources, I always use LWDM.net. I use the Kernel Newbies site to review features of different kernels. And I highly recommend that you can go to elinux.org. And if you want to kind of see what things are available from past conferences, include that in your search, elinux.org, when you search the web, and Google will almost always take you to some of our slides where we preserve them. And then there's also the C-Linux definition. That's all I've got for today. So thank you very much for your time, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Yep. Well, just a second.
Oh, there I am.
Here you are. Okay, I have some discussion item, and maybe first I'd like to talk about F2FS. I'm curious about F2FS current situation, and currently F2FS is enhancing its feature like quick boot or such kind of things. But yeah. I'm just something curious about who is actually using for what kind of purposes for F2FS and some kind of the future prospect of the F2FS to be grown or something limited to some of the limited use cases. Do you have some idea?
Well, I actually don't know who's using F2FS. I know Samsung proposed it, and I assume I think I have heard that they are actually using F2FS in some of their phones, because I believe at one of the events, I'm trying to remember which one it was, there was someone who said that they had checked and F2FS was in use on one of the Samsung phones. So I believe it has been made in production. I don't know who else is using it. It does have these features. They're continuing to work on it in open source, which I think is really positive. I think most developers who are using block-based flash file systems, things that go on MMC, which is most of the phones. I don't know of any phones these days that are using raw flash, are using EXT4 or something else. So I guess to answer your question, I know Samsung has used it, or at least I hear that Samsung has used it, but I don't know of other people.
Okay. Another thing is about LLVM. I have made some of the survey over here. GCC runtime modules, license exception columns. And I found that it's pretty easy to use GCC's runtime module. Even if we do not use GCC, we can use that kind of runtime module provided with the GCC, even together with the LLVM or some of the proprietary compilers, so that I hope you guys sitting here to look into the GCC license exception, and you will find quite important notice there, and will find quite good information there, I believe.
Yeah, that sounds good.
This is that GCC has a great GDL exception, and that is applied to the GCC provided runtime module. And runtime module itself have a quite same exception they have, and they do not restricting the use of those kind of runtime module for the GCC, but they are allowing them to be used for another system, like LLVM or those kind of proprietary compilers, so that it should be noted. And I hope everybody to look into the license term and will be able to find good terms. And I do not mention such kind of decisive thing about the license issue, which is quite critical, but I hope you to do.
Okay. Yeah, that's good information.
Yeah. Another thing is about energy-aware scheduling issue. I think energy-aware scheduling will be not only for the interest for the embedded system, but for the enterprise systems such as blade servers or those kind of people. That's something of the tradition of this kind of energy-saving issue. But who is the main promoter of the energy-aware scheduling system?
That's a good question. So far, it appears that the people working on embedded devices have been pushing it, but there is interest by people in the data center. Now, a lot of the energy-aware scheduling has been revolving around things like big dot little, and so those are not really in use in the data center. Those types of designs are really intended for mobile devices that are operating on battery. But to the degree that we see ARM, particularly ARM64, get deployed in the data center, we may see some of these other energy-aware scheduling things show up there. For some reason, it hasn't had, I haven't seen a lot of this work going on, or maybe I'm not that close to it, but I haven't seen a lot of it going on in the x86 space. So right now, it appears that a lot of this scheduling work is being driven from the mobile space.
Another information is just for you, but I got to know the person who are working with the Raspberry Pi with the Sony UKS, you know, plan. So that if you have interest to invite those kind of people to the Embedded Linux Conference Europe or somewhere else to make some of the presentation by them, maybe I will be able to give you some of the contact information of those kind of people. It doesn't mean that they are they are promising us to make such kind of presentation, but the relationship in between the such kind of established manufacturing site and open source community people will be one of the interesting topics, I believe.
Yeah, that would be very interesting to see if they were interested in coming to ELC or ELC Europe and hear what they have to say.
Okay. Anyway. Do you have any questions or discussion here?
Yes.
Okay, Vanessa.
Hi, Jim. This is Kobayashi from Toshiba. I have two questions. One question is about overlay FS. I'm not familiar with Union FS, but I tried to use Union FS, but unfortunately, I give up. Because it was very complicated. What do you think? What is the most biggest advantage between compare with Union FS and Overlay FS?
Well, I'm not an expert in either. I haven't actually played with either of them. But from what I've read on the internet, Overlay FS actually is quite a bit simpler to use. And I don't know the details, but the article I read, I'm trying to remember what it said. I think it's in terms of managing the two file systems, I think the Overlay FS was a little bit more automatic in terms of sending the file system request to the right file system. But that's a pretty high-level answer. I wish I had more detail on that.
Okay, I try to investigate. Yeah. Thank you very much. And the second question is about the LLVM for Linux. I think you have already tried to use GCC for runtime optimizations and presented in the ESC last year. Do you have any idea to use LLVM for such kind of runtime optimization or something?
Well, yes. Actually, the reason that I got kind of excited about LLVM in the first place was when I was doing my size reduction work. The LLVM at the time had much better support for some of the optimization features that I was interested in for that size work. So unfortunately, I'm not really working on the size work anymore. But I had a lot of problems. At the time I did the work, I had, even GCC was, I think I was right in the transition between GCC 4.6 and 4.7. And so the GCC support for link time optimization was very immature. It was very new at that point, and I had a lot of problems with it. I had to build my own tool chain and apply patches and things like that. But I did get it to work. So in terms of what I've actually accomplished, I've actually got GCC to compile the kernel, with link time optimization. I never did get that far with LLVM, and the primary reason was that the LLVM support was out of tree. I had enough work just to get the LTO patches in and to get GCC up and running, but I didn't have enough time to also go off and run down a whole set of other patches. And at that time, there were quite a few. This was probably 2 years ago, and there were at least 150 patches to get LLVM support in the kernel. So, if I were still doing the project today, I would definitely be looking at doing GCC LTO link time optimization and LLVM link time optimization. In my opinion, LLVM has a little bit better features, and it's a little bit easier to work with because the access to the formatting, well, the access to the output from each optimization stage is a little bit easier under LLVM, in my opinion.
Thank you very much.
So, anyway, I hope that answered your question.
Yeah. Thank you.
Cool.
Thank you for presentations. I'm another Ueda from Sony LSI Design. So this is my first time to attend this meeting. And so in your presentation, I think so there is a topic for Internet of Things activity in this working group.
Yes, right.
Yeah. And so I'm interested in what type of the topic are discussing or will be discussed in the topic. For example, the implementation limitation on the IoT device or the new future for IoT device. Because I'm doing so verification for wired system 802.11, so I'm very interested in how IoT future impact on the wired system in Linux.
Yeah, so that's a good question. Unfortunately, the IoT project is just barely starting. And so we had the kind of the biggest thing we've done so far is at ELC Europe, we had a birds of a feather session. We're having a little bit of problem coming up with requirements on this. So the main requirements that dropped out of the birds of a feather session at ELC Europe were around security, networking. There are some people who say that the networking that's being proposed now, there's kind of two levels of networking. There's kind of full IPv6 with security that's being proposed for sensors. There's a lot of people complaining that that is way too heavyweight. The other one that is a little bit more flexible is the all-seeing solution. That is also a little bit heavyweight. So there are a lot of people who are saying they'd like to see an IoT solution on the low end for sensors that is using kind of less costly protocols, possibly UDP or something else. But everybody wants an open protocol. And in particular, Panasonic has been suggesting the use of a lighter weight security mechanism for a not IPv6 solution. They haven't actually presented what they're doing yet. We expect them to have a suggestion, possibly an implementation for people to review. Well, they said by the end of the year, but it's getting really close to the end of the year, so I don't know when we're going to see that. But so basically, a couple of the results, people looking at this are saying security is a really big deal, particularly the network security. AllJoin has a solution for that, but it's kind of costly. And Panasonic seems to think that they have a solution that's less costly that would make more sense for sensors. Everybody kind of, in one way, the other, there's kind of two main areas of Internet of Things. There's the sensor, which is the really low end, and then there's the gateway. And if you look out at the marketplace today, you see that Linux has pretty much already won the gateway. I mean, I have some sensors on my solar panels on my roof, and they're not running Linux, but the little white box that's in my garage that relays this information out to the cloud is running Linux, and I think almost everybody, you know, Nest is running Linux. A whole bunch of these gateway devices that talk to the sensors is already running Linux. So that's actually not a problem we need to invest in because it seems to be solving itself. The bigger issue is compatibility and particularly security. So besides the protocols and security, we still have a bunch of work we could do on kernel size. And then the last area that the head of the IoT project, which is a guy from Panasonic, has said is a really, really big issue is infield upgrades. And particularly the security around infield upgrades. We're going to have a really, really big problem in the Internet of Things space if 10 years from now we have deployed a bunch of sensors running Linux and we have no way to upgrade them. because invariably there's going to be a security flaw found. And so there are people who are saying, well, just make sure it doesn't have flaws. It's like, that's just not realistic. Anything that has a networking protocol on it is going to, you know, you have to plan for the possibility that there's a flaw in the networking and that you are going to need to securely update the system in the field. And so that's a whole area that I think might be one of the big focuses. But the main focus of the IoT meeting in March is going to be around requirements and the specific projects that we want to address. I kind of doubt that we'll address networking because there's enough people focused on the networking aspects of it that I don't think that's useful for the CE workgroup to do. But I do think that we may be looking at kernel size and secure upgrades and possibly some of the security around networking, but depends on what Panasonic has to propose there.
Thank you very much.
I think I will be able to add some more information to him privately. Any other questions here? Okay, maybe it's time to close up his presentation. Thank you very much, Tim, and we have to say Merry Christmas and New Year's
holiday. Yes, Merry Christmas and Happy New Year, and I hope to see all of you sometime soon. In March, if you can make it to the Embedded Linux Conference. Oh, there you go. Hello.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay.